this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change your life.
This morning we're going to study one of the most instructive parables that Jesus gave to the multitudes and especially to his disciples. Most of the parables that Jesus gave were not explained in the scripture. We have to search the scriptures and compare scripture with scripture to discover the meaning of what Jesus is talking about. However, this parable is one of the few parables that is explained explicitly right in the Bible, just a few verses after it is recorded. Of course, those who have the writings of Ellen White have a marvelous advantage in attempting to understand the meaning of these parables, because Ellen White wrote a book, this book, called Christ's Object Lessons. This book discusses the parables of Jesus. It explains in the first part of the book why he spoke in parables, and then it goes through the major parables that he gave. It is a marvelous assistance and help in understanding the meaning of the parables. But we will study this parable, first of all, just from the Bible and see what the Bible says. We will see the parable, first of all, and then we will look at how Jesus himself explained it. Because this is one of the parables that Jesus himself explained to his disciples. It is so important. This parable is so important that in the writings of the Spirit of Prophecy, it is referred to literally hundreds of times. Let's look at it. It's generally called the parable of the wheat and the tares, or just the parable of the tares in the field. And it is recorded in Matthew, the 13th chapter. The actual parable itself is found in verses 24 to 30 of Matthew 13, which says, "Another parable he put forth to them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servants of the owner came and said to him, Sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares? He said to them, An enemy has done this. The servant said to him, Do you want us then to go and gather them up? But he said, No. Lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and at the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, First, gather together the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn." This parable intrigued the disciples so much that they wanted a special explanation of what this parable meant. And so we read a few verses down, starting in verse 35, that it says that, verse 36, it says, Jesus sent the multitude away and went into the house. So now Jesus is not with the multitude. He's given the parable to all the people that we just read. But now he's not with the multitude anymore. He's in private in the house with his disciples. And it says, and his disciples came to him, saying, Explain to us the parable of the tares of the field. Now they had just heard him giving many parables, but of all the parables that they heard, this apparently was the one that they most wanted to have an explanation for. They didn't understand it, and they wanted to understand this parable of the wheat and the tares. The one that sowed the good seed, the field, the enemy that came while men were sleeping and sowed tares. And then they both grew together until the harvest. And then they were separated and the tares were bound in bundles and they were burned up. And the good seed was gathered into the barn. They wanted to understand what this was. They knew it wasn't the literal planting of seed. When Jesus gave these parables, by the way, you could look out in the wheat fields, Ellen White said, and you could see people scattering seed. You could see them scattering seed. You could see them sowing seed. But the disciples knew that this parable was not about the natural world. They knew that. They knew that this parable had to do with the spiritual world and with the kingdom of heaven, because it begins like this. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. So the disciples knew it had to do with the kingdom of heaven. It had to do with the spiritual world, with spiritual things, and they didn't understand it, and they came to Jesus and they said, explain this to us. And so, Jesus explained this parable in just a few words. Notice what he said, starting in verse 37. He answered and said to them, he who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seeds are the sons of the kingdom. But the tares are the sons of the wicked one. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age. And the reapers are the angels. Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of this age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. When Jesus used the expression, he who has ears to hear, let him hear, he's telling us that he has just told us something very, very important. So we better pay attention. We better pay attention. He's just told us something that has to do with our eternal destiny. Let's look first of all at the field. The field in which the seed is sown. Jesus said, he who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. But now remember, Jesus is not talking about the physical world, the physical earth. He's talking about the kingdom of heaven. So he's talking about the spiritual world. He's talking about the spiritual world. Where is the spiritual world? Where is the spiritual world? Well, when you're talking about the spiritual world, that place where people grow up as good seed to be ready for the kingdom of God, where is it that people grow up to maturity to become ready for the kingdom of God? Where is that in the world? It's the spiritual world, remember. Well, that, of course, is in the church. It's very important. If you want to be saved, it is very important for you to be a member of the church. I think so often what Elder H.M.S. Richards Sr. used to say, he used to ask this question, do you go to church? And then he would answer the question. For those who could not say yes, they went to church, he would say, do you go to church? And then he would say, if not, why not? If the church was not important, Jesus would not have established it. Now, does that make sense? If the church wasn't important, Jesus wouldn't have founded it. He wouldn't have established it. It is in the church where people grow up, where the good seed grows up to maturity so that they're ready for the kingdom of heaven. That's where it happens. Don't let anybody tell you that, oh, it doesn't matter whether you go to church or not. It doesn't matter whether you're part of the church or not. The church is the spiritual world where the seed is planted and it grows up to maturity. If you don't ever go to church, how are you going to receive the good seed? The church is the place where the Holy Spirit is constantly planting seed. The Son of Man is planting the good seed. Let's just read this in the book Christ Object Lessons, page 70. She explains it like this. The field, Christ said, is the world, but we must understand this as signifying the church of Christ in the world. The parable is a description of that which pertains to the kingdom of God. Remember, in verse 24, the very first thing that Jesus said is, the kingdom of heaven is like this. So this parable is about the kingdom of heaven. It's not about the natural world, the secular world, the earthly world. It's not about that. It's about the kingdom of heaven. The parable is a description of that which pertains to the kingdom of God, his work of salvation of men, and this work is accomplished through the church. The work that Jesus is doing to save mankind, he is working through the church to do this. So don't let anybody tell you it doesn't matter whether you go to church or not. It doesn't matter whether you're a member of the church or not. It makes all the difference in the world in regard to your personal salvation. Well, somebody says, Pastor John, I know somebody that can't go to church. Oh, yes, I know many somebodies that can't go to church. My own father was in a situation at one time during the Second World War when, as a soldier, 12,000 miles away from home, he was isolated for periods of time from the church. He could not go to church and he could not associate with fellow believers. So that has happened many times. There are people right now that cannot go to church, cannot associate with the church because they're sick. They're in the hospital. They're infirm. They're too weak to get in a car and come to any church. There are people like that. Daniel was in a situation like that. Daniel could not go to church. His church had been destroyed. The Jewish church, their old church organization, the whole thing had been destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar's armies. There were no sacrificial system, priests, offerings, temple, anything. The temple was in ruins. And Daniel was down in Babylon, and he was not able to associate with the church as he had been able to do down in Jerusalem. But God protected him, and God will protect you if you're in a dungeon, if you're in prison, if you're in hospital, if you're in some place and you're isolated from God's people and you call aloud to Him, He will hear your cry and He will protect you and guard you and be with you even if you're all by yourself. But, and this is a big but what if you're not in that situation? What if you are not in the hospital? You're not in prison. What if you're not so weak that you can't get out of bed? What if you're not 12,000 miles away from home as a soldier in the army? And you have the opportunity to associate with God's people, to be in the church, but you don't take it. Friend, if you do that, that's presumption, and you cannot expect that God is going to work a miracle to help you to grow up to full maturity and be ready for the harvest time. Be ready to gather it into the garner. If you don't take advantage of the spiritual opportunities and privileges, the opportunities of grace that God gives you, don't ever make a mistake about it. I can tell you from a number of decades of careful observation that I have done on this subject since I have worked as a pastor and a teacher for a long enough time to see this happen over and over again. People that voluntarily keep themselves away from church also go into a Laodicean, lukewarm condition. Instead of growing up ready for the harvest, tares get planted in the heart, and they're not ready. Instead of going up, they're going down spiritually. So, the field is the church. Don't ever think that it's not important whether or not you belong to the church. Don't ever think that it's not important whether or not you go to church. It makes all the difference in the world in regard to your salvation. The field is the world, the spiritual world, the church. If you don't go to church, you're not even in the field. How do you expect the plan of salvation to take place in your life? It says, His work of salvation for men, and this work is accomplished through the church. True, the Holy Spirit has gone out into all the world. Everywhere it is moving upon the hearts of men, but it is in the church that we are to grow and ripen for the garner of God. Where is it that we're going to grow and ripen for the garner of God? It's in the church. It's not down at the club. It's not at the swimming pool. It's not on the golf links. It's not in the library. It's not on vacation in a motel. It's in the church. It's in the church. Don't ever make a mistake on that, friend. There are multitudes all around today. I've seen it over and over again in this place and in every other place that I've lived. I've seen it over and over again. People have said, well, you know, there's so many hypocrites in the church. You know, so many tares in the church. There's so many tares, so many hypocrites in the church, I'm not even going to go to church. And they start to slip and they go downhill spiritually. They're not even in the field where the growing takes place. They absent themselves from the very place where God has designed through the work of the Holy Spirit and His divine grace to prepare them for heaven. So the field is the world, not the natural world, the spiritual world. That's the church. That's the place where the seed grows up to full maturity. But of course, no matter how fertile the field is, even if you're in the church, it won't do any good unless you get the good seed planted in your heart. And what is the good seed? Oh, this is a wonderful, wonderful Bible topic, the good seed. It's a topic that began to be proclaimed to the world in promise by the God of heaven clear back in Genesis, the 3rd chapter in the 15th verse. It talked about the seed. And Paul talks about this seed, the good seed, here in Galatians. Galatians, the 3rd chapter. And verse 16 says, "Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds as of many, but as of one. And to your seed, who is Christ." Jesus is the seed. Somebody says, how can Jesus be the seed and the sower both? Well, how can Jesus be the sacrifice and the priest both? He is. Notice what the Bible says about Jesus as the seed. First of all, notice Jesus' own words. In John, the 12th chapter, verse 24, Jesus here is speaking of his crucifixion. And he says, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain." Now, of course, this is a spiritual seed. Not a literal seed. It is a spiritual seed. It has to do with what happens in the mind. And when you come to church, seed, spiritual ideas, thoughts are planted in your mind. Now what happens when this seed of truth, when the true seed is planted in a person's mind? First of all, let's read one more text to see what the seed is all about. In John the 18th chapter, the word seed is not used here, but this explains what the seed is, what the spiritual seed is. John the 18th chapter, Jesus is talking to Pilate, and he says in verse 37, "Jesus answered, 'You say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice.'" Jesus said, "I am the good seed. I bear witness to the truth. The reason that I came here, the reason I was born into this world, was to bear witness to the truth, and everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." Notice what it says about that again here in Revelation, the 19th chapter. Here it's talking about the second coming. And it says in verse 11, "Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war." And then notice what it says about him in verse 13. "He was dipped with a robe, he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God." The name of Jesus is called the Word of God. That is the name that he has given over and over again in the Gospel of John. He is called the Word of God. And so, when you receive the words of Jesus, when you listen to his word, you were receiving good seeds. That's the way he planted it. That's the way he planted the spiritual seed. He spoke the word, and as people listened, the good seed of the truth, the gospel, was planted in their mind. Now, if you receive this seed, you receive the word into your mind. His name is the Word of God. When he spoke, he planted the seed of truth, the gospel, into men's minds. If you receive this seed into your mind, what will happen to you? What will happen to you? When a husband impregnates his wife with a seed, that woman has a baby. That's a birth. And when Jesus speaks his word, and that word, that the seed of that word enters your mind, a new birth will occur. And notice the way it's described by the Apostle John in 1 John, the 3rd chapter. The seed must be planted in order for the new birth to occur. 1 John, the 3rd chapter, and verses 4 to 10. It says, whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin, because he has been born of God. Notice, if you have been born again, how were you born? The seed was planted in your mind. The Son of Man sows good seed. The seed is planted in your mind, and that seed begins to grow and to reproduce itself, just like in your physical body. Every cell in your body, you have chromosomes, and you have genetic material that you receive from your father. And you have it throughout your whole body. So, that genetic material controls everything that happens in the body. It's the control mechanism. We call it heredity. And the same is true in regard to the spiritual birth. When I receive the Word of God into my mind, that is spiritual seed. And when that grows up, there's a new birth. And the result of me receiving that seed is that I quit sinning. That is as plain as you can read it here in the Bible. Notice what it says. It says, whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him. And he cannot sin because he has been born of God. The new birth occurs and a person quits sinning. That is the evidence that the seed has been planted. And that it's growing. And then notice what he says in verse 10. He said, in this, or by this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not love his brother. So, the field is the church, the minds of men in the church, and the seed is planted in the mind by the Word of God. The Word of God is the seed. Jesus' name is the Word of God. He is the good seed. He plants His Word, the very thoughts that He has. Through His Word, He plants those thoughts in your mind and my mind. And if we receive this seed and it grows up, we will quit sinning and start practicing righteousness, and we will love our brother. That's what it says in 1 John 3:10. And this is a proof that we're the children of God. And if that doesn't happen, we're not the children of God no matter what we say. No matter what we profess. Because the good seed is not growing up in our life. What will happen? What will happen when the good seed grows up and is ready for the harvest? Notice what John says here in 1 John 3. He says in verse 2, beloved, now we are children of God, because see, we've had the new birth. The seed's in us. We're not children of the devil anymore. We're children of God because we've had the new birth. The seed has been planted in us. The Son of Man has planted the good seed in our mind. It has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when He is revealed, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as it is. You ever seen somebody, and you've heard this expression about a little boy, and they say, well, he's just a chip off the old block. What are they talking about? Well, they say, the boy resembles his father. In the same way, when the spiritual seed is implanted in my mind, when it grows up at harvest time, I will resemble the father. It says that we're going to be like him. We will think like him, speak like him, act like him. Because we've received the seed, we quit sinning. The power of the gospel has grown up in our life. But now we have to look at something not so wonderful, not so pretty. In fact, it's awful, and yet is one of the focal points of the parables. This parable of the wheat and the tares. Remember, the field is the church. It represents the minds of men in the church who are to receive the good seed. The gospel. And they're associated together in the church. But the devil is also seeking access to the minds of men. Notice what Jesus says here in Matthew 13. He says in verse 39, "The enemy who sowed them," that is the tares, "the enemy who sowed them is the devil." The devil is seeking access to the minds of men in order to sow or plant tares in their minds. Ellen White wrote about this, Volume 5, Bible Commentary. She said, "As the presence of the tares among the wheat counteracted to a great degree the work of the sower, so sin among the people of God frustrates in a measure the plan of Jesus to save fallen man from the power of Satan and render the barren ground of the human heart fruitful of good works." Isn't that awful? This actually is a very sad story, and it is very real. We live in a world where, because of the fall of Adam and Eve, the devil has access also to people's minds. Now, he cannot force himself upon you, but he does have access to tempt you to plant tares, and the devil plants tares. We're going to look at how they're planted in a little while. But the devil plants tares in men's minds, and these tares we just read, they counteract the work of the gospel in the mind. So you have people in the church, and tares are planted in their mind. Now, this is very serious. Because in the physical world, think of what happens in the physical world. Have you ever seen a garden? Have you ever seen a field where the weeds got so thick that it choked out the wheat? That can happen, can't it? And that can happen in the spiritual world too. The tares can grow up and choke out the wheat. And so at the harvest time, the field of my mind, remember, the field is the world, the spiritual world, the church. It's all the minds of the people in the church. It's my mind. My mind is part of the field. At the time of the judgment, at the time of the harvest, if the tares have choked out the wheat, my field, my mind is full of tares. In fact, if it even has one tare that has grown up to maturity, that will eliminate me from the wheat harvest. I will be in the harvest of the tares. And so this is a very serious and very sad development. It was so sad that Jesus said that the servants came and they said, "Well, do you want us to root up the tares?" And he said, "No." He said, "No." The devil is sowing the tares. And how often is the devil sowing tares? Well, let's just read how often the devil sows tares. This is from the Home Missionary, 1890. Ellen White wrote this. "Satan is no idler. He watches his chances and takes advantage of every opportunity to win souls to his side. He constantly sows his tares in every heart that is not barricaded with the truth. The people of God are in a condition of slumber. They do not discern what favorable opportunities for winning souls they are letting slip by. It has been shown to me that Satan is stealing a march upon us." So, Satan is constantly sowing tares in every heart that is not barricaded with the truth. He's constantly sowing them. And he has assistants that work along with him. He has assistants that work along with him to sow more tares. And what are these tares? Well, the tares, again, just as the good seed is the word of truth or the gospel that's implanted into the mind, and it reproduces in the heart the character, the image, the character of God. The tares are the spiritual ideas, philosophy of Satan that are planted in the mind, and if those philosophy, if those thoughts, if they grow up to full maturity, they will ruin the effect of the gospel in your heart and your mind. And you'll be ruined for eternity. Now, the tares are a big subject, and we're going to have to spend most of the rest of our time together this morning looking at what the tares are, because you need to know what the tares are so that you can know if the devil has some tares growing in your mind, and those tares must be uprooted and taken out of your mind, or otherwise they will wreck you, ruin you for the day of judgment. And in the spirit of prophecy, we have been given much instruction as to what these tares are. And we must look right now at what the tares are. And you must ask yourself the question, are there any tares growing up in my mind? If there are, they must come out. Otherwise, I will be ruined in the day of judgment. We are able to assist the devil in sowing tares. Listen to this. This is from Review and Herald, February 1897. So one unkind, harsh word, and this seed, finding soil in the minds of the hearers, will spring up to bear fruit after its kind. So one seed in loving, gentle, Christ-like words, and it will bring you rich returns. Let us guard ourselves, lest we speak words that are not a blessing, but a curse. If we sow wheat, we shall reap wheat. If we sow tares, we shall reap tares. And the harvest, whether of wheat or of tares, will be sure and abundant. What are the tares? Oh, unkind, harsh words. As you speak those words, you're developing a character. You're developing a habit. And they don't speak words like that in heaven. That's a tare, and no tares can be taken to heaven. Those have to be uprooted from your character, because if they're not, in the day of judgment, you will be bound in bundles with the tares and burned in the fire. Our words can be tares. And then there are the false pretensions of piety. The sinners in Zion. The sinners in Zion. Ellen White says about them, she says, there are many sinners in Zion, and they are likened to tares among the wheat. A tare is not a person who is living in open sin. No, openly, they profess to be part of the church. They profess to keep the commandments of God. But there's some secret sin in their life. Read the chapter in Christ Object Lessons on the parable of the tares. She goes over that very clearly. The tares are people that openly, they look like they're righteous, like Judas did. He looked like, do you realize, friends, that if Judas had died about 24 hours before he did die, by committing suicide, that all the disciples, Ellen White says, that all the disciples would have thought that this was a terrible calamity, that he would have been greatly missed, and that they would have thought of him as being one of the leading disciples. But he was a tare. He had something inside that they didn't know about. A tare is a person that outwardly looks like they're wheat. Remember, when the tares first come up, they look like wheat. But inside, there is something wrong. There is some kind of sin that's hidden. They make a pretension of piety, but Ellen White says the tares have a false pretension of piety. Here's what she says. Sinners who make false pretensions of piety mingle together for a time with the true followers of Christ, and this external semblance of Christianity is calculated to deceive many. The tares so closely resembled the wheat that the laborers might easily be deceived when the blades were green. So, false pretensions of piety, they look like the wheat, but something inside isn't right. They're sinners in Zion. Ellen White refers to them in the book Christ Object Lessons as false brethren. Notice, they are not true brethren. They're false brethren. She calls them also pretended believers. They're not really believers, they're pretended believers, because the work of the gospel has not gone to the heart. The tares are not coming out of their life. There's some secret sin inside. So, she calls them in Christ Object Lessons, page 72 and 73, false brethren, not true brethren, and pretended believers. And these tares sow tares. And part of the tares that they sow are the tares of unbelief and doubt in God's Word. These tares, by the way, can be the leaders in the church. Remember, Judas was a leader in the church. And he was considered to be the leading disciple. And yet he was a tare. And so it is possible for a tare to be, in fact, very often, the tares are in positions of leadership. Elders, deacons, preachers, evangelists, pastors, administrators. Notice what Ellen White says about this. There are those in responsible positions who by their words and actions sow seeds of doubt and unbelief. These seeds are called tares by our Lord, and those who sow it are under the guidance of evil angels. They are at work both openly and secretly, seeking to counteract the work which God has appointed His divine agencies to perform through human agencies. All who do this work see with defective and perverted eyesight. Their imagination is inspired by satanic agencies, and they see many things in a false light. And then she goes on to say how that if they don't repent, someday they'll be like Esau. They'll find out it's too late to repent. They have clung to some secret hidden sin. And I want to tell you, friend, if there's some hidden secret sin that you're practicing in your life, you may outwardly be keeping all the commandments of God and be part of the church, but if there's some secret hidden sin in your life, if there's unbelief in your heart, you cannot play a game with God. God knows what your situation is. He knows what your condition is. It is possible for us to cooperate with the devil by sowing tares, by sowing unbelief, by sowing wrong philosophies in our literature. We need to be careful what kind of literature we're giving to our people in our churches and to our young people. Notice what Ellen White said about this. She said, "Will you not pledge yourself to God that your seed sowing shall be that which will produce not tares but a harvest of wheat? God will work with you. He will increase your usefulness. He has entrusted to you talents that in His strength you may use to produce a precious harvest. I asked, where is your spiritual discernment or your good judgment that you should thus sow tares among the wheat? Nothing is to appear in our literature that does not represent truth and righteousness." Oh, friends, we are never to give to our young people literature that contains the seeds of doubt, unbelief, skepticism. We do not need tares sown into the minds of our young people. Those questions of doubt will grow up. And when they become adults, the parents will come to pastors and they say, "What has happened to my son? I took him to Sabbath school. I took him to church. I raised him in the church, and now he doesn't believe anything." It's happened thousands of times in our ranks. We don't know what our children are reading, what they're looking at. We're allowing them, their minds to be sowed with tares. We should not allow anything to appear in the literature that we give to our young people that is not truth and righteousness. We should not have anything that has unbelief, skepticism, falsehood in it. We should not be teaching our young people to go to the places of worldly amusement. Did you know that that's one of the tares that the devil's trying to sow into the minds of our young people? Let me read that to you. Places of worldly amusement. Ellen White wrote to our young people, she says, "It is anything but wise, my young friends, to seek your own pleasure, to sow a crop of tares in foolish, sinful actions, which will not only lead others to do the same, but will bring forth a bitter harvest for your own reaping." Oh, if you're going to places, your life is a comedy. You're a joker. You want to tell funny stories. You want to be engaged in worldly amusement. The devil has all kinds of worldly amusement. He can fill your whole life with that kind of laughter and amusement. And at the end of the world, what will you have to show for it? You know, there are some people, they have had much grief later in life because they got in such a habit of jesting and joking. Those kind of thoughts and actions and words are tares. They got in such a habit of jesting and joking that people never knew whether to believe anything they said or not because there were so many jokes. And so when they tried to testify to the Lord, the people listened, And they didn't know whether to believe it or not. Was it real or not? They didn't know what was real and what was a joke. But then there are other ideas that the devil plants in people's minds called heresies. Heresies. These are part of the tares planted in people's minds so that they will not be ready for the day of judgment. Sometimes, this is This Day with God, page 126. Sometimes that which men teach as special light is in reality specious error, which as tares sown among the wheat will spring up and produce a baleful harvest, and errors of this sort will be entertained by some until the close of this earth's history. So, heresies. The errors, the coldness, the darkness. The devil wants to plant those kinds of things in your life. Ellen White writes, the tares are mingled with the wheat, error with truth, coldness with zeal, darkness with light. The error, the coldness, the darkness, the lack of refinement. Did you know, friend, that Jesus was always refined? And if he has planted the truth in my heart and my life, I am going to overcome all coarseness, all my rough ways, all my blunt attitude. We read this in Review and Herald, 1890. It says, the Christian, and especially the minister, is an educator if he presents coarse, rough ways. Those who have less knowledge and experience will follow in his wake, and so the sowing of tares goes on from one to another. And if these deficiencies are not overcome, they will result in the destruction of souls for whom Christ died. Notice, if I do not overcome my coarse, rough ways, what will happen if I don't overcome it? Souls will be lost. Every Christian minister needs to pay attention to that statement. If there's any coarseness, any lack of refinement in our speech, in our actions, in our thoughts, well, then we have a tear in our mind, in our heart, that must be overcome. Any lack of refinement. Jesus was refined. He had always social grace. We are to have that same refinement if we have had the good seed planted in our mind. The cold, critical spirit, the coldness, the darkness, the lack of refinement, all of that, those are tares. They must come out of the heart, out of the life. Our speech, evil speaking, is a tear. Evil speaking is a tear. And it results in many, many trials in the church. Ellen White wrote this, many a church trial is the result of personal likes and dislikes. Evil surmisings have led to evil speaking and accusing. Because of some mistake in business dealing, men have become suspicious of their brethren. Instead of going to their brethren privately and speaking plainly to them of their errors, thus manifesting true love and removing the cloud of difficulty, they have brought about a church trial and would have the questions which vex them settled by the church by digging up the supposed tares. Many have been severed from the church because of these personal spites and have been thrown upon the enemy's battleground where they have become discouraged and through manifold temptations have fallen into the very sins of which they were accused. Isn't that terrible? People that actually were innocent, but we were so vigorous to accuse them and to dig up the tares, they were separated from the church and eventually they fell into the very sins of which they were accused. And friends, if we've done that in the day of judgment, we're going to have to face it. We're going to have to face the fact if there are people that were severed from the church because we decided they were tares. And then they fell into the very sins of which they were innocent, but of which we accused them. Do you know accusing somebody of something is a very serious thing? Because in the very act of accusing them, we increase the devil's temptation. What is the if the devil is tempting them on that very point? And so then we accuse them of it. What do? We make the temptation more severe. We make the temptation more severe. Evil speaking. Evil surmising, which have led to evil speaking and accusing, results in church trials. And then there's another kind of a terror that's really common today. And that is the terror that the devil's planting all over, the terror of fanaticism. Look at what Ellen White says about this. This is Five Manuscript Releases, 242. The Lord has wrought in your midst, and Satan, who is ever active, watching for a favorable opportunity, has intruded himself to mingle fanaticism with God's work, to sow tares with the good seed. Fanaticism. What is fanaticism? Fanaticism is going beyond what the Bible says. Now, we need to live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And we will never become fanatical by doing what God says and not doing what God says not to do. We will not become fanatical doing that. We can live by every word Jesus said. Jesus told that to the devil. But the devil wants to lead people to go beyond what God's word says. Now, they'll always tell you they're not. They'll always read a scripture to you to prove that what they're doing is right. But it's going beyond what the Word of God actually says. Fanaticism. God's going to have a people that aren't fanatical, that will simply live by the Word and won't go beyond what it says. We must pray that all seeds of fanaticism come out of our hearts. By the way, when the seed of fanaticism takes root in a person's heart, even when that seed comes out, the person is spiritually weakened. Fanaticism is extremely dangerous. One of the reasons for a church organization, one of the reasons why we're supposed to have elders and deacons, is to help those that are weak in the church to avoid going off onto the tangents of fanaticism. That's one of the main reasons for a church organization. Not the only one, but one of the main reasons. If somebody's trying to teach you some new doctrine or teaching, you need to say to yourself, well, before I accept this, I'm going to counsel with brethren of experience. I'm going to check it out in the Word and counsel with brethren of experience about this. In fact, Ellen White says, if the brethren of experience don't see light in it, just leave it alone. Just leave it alone. If it's really the truth, God can bring it to the forefront at the right time. And then there are the worldly cares and riches and pleasures. Ellen White refers to these as some of the devil's tares. Worldly riches, pleasures, and cares. There's the harshness, the lack of sympathy. This harshness, lack of sympathy, those are tares that the devil plants in our hearts and minds that have to come out if we're going to be ready for the judgment. Remember, just one tare that fully grows up to maturity in your heart and life will wreck you for the day of judgment. It will ruin you for eternity. Harshness and lack of sympathy are spoken of in the spirit of prophecy as tares. They are very, very serious. We should never, ever be harsh or have a lack of sympathy for each other. We need to be praying for each other, friends, in historic Adventism, that we will overcome all this harshness that we have seen expressed among ourselves in the past few years. We must overcome it. Harshness, lack of sympathy, is a tear. It will wreck us. It will ruin us for eternity if it does not come out of our hearts. Jesus was never unsympathetic, even for his enemies. Even for those that were the worst of sinners, he was never harsh with his enemies. With the very agents of Satan, he was never harsh. He was always courteous. The false theories. The devil is busy trying to bring in all kinds of false theories, deceptive theories, so that we will not be ready for the harvest. Here's what Ellen White wrote about this. She said, the warnings and the messages that the Lord has graciously given me to correct the errors that would come in and to set things in order, the people should have. That's the writings of Ellen White. For the enemy will continue to work to bring in false theories and to mingle with the truth strange suppositions. These appear as light to those who receive them, but they are deceptive theories that will be brought in as tares sown among the wheat. The Lord has for the last 50 years been instructing me when the seducing theories would arise that they were not to be received, and I must do as Moses and Joshua, repeat the errors of the past and the gracious working out of the Lord's will. Oh, friend, if you want to be preserved from the false theories and deceptive theories that Satan has planted in the church. You must get and study and read the spirit of prophecy. They will protect you from these false deceptive theories and from fanaticism. But then, summing it all up, what is the overwhelming big problem with the tares that excludes them from the kingdom of God in the day of judgment and causes them to receive a sentence of eternal damnation? The overwhelming result of the tares in the life is that there is no fruit in the harvest time, and therefore they're worthless. Ellen White wrote this concerning some people who are making a profession of religion. She said, "They have never been converted, and unless their hearts are sanctified through the truth which they have accepted, they will be bound up with the tares, for they bear no clusters of precious fruit to show that they are branches of the living vine." How is it in your life? Are you bearing fruit? If the good seed has been planted in your mind and if it's growing up, some fruit will be developing. In fact, all the fruit of the Spirit will be present. Desire of Ages 676, not one will be missing. The fruit of the Spirit will all be present in your life. Every single one. Not just love, joy, and peace, but gentleness, faith, self-control, humility or meekness. It'll all be present. All of the fruit of the Holy Spirit will be present in your life if the good seed is there. The overwhelming problem with the tares at the end of the world is that there is no fruit. There's no spiritual fruit. And if there's no fruit in your life, friend, you can say, "Well, I believe." You can make the profession. You can say, "I'm a member of the church." You can say anything you want. But if there's no fruit, you're not going to the garner with the wheat. You're going to be bound with bundles with the tares. How is it in your life? Are the tares being uprooted in your life? Are they being destroyed so that the good seed of the gospel can grow to full maturity? How is it, friend? How is it for you? If you're going to have eternal life, the tares must be completely out and the wheat must grow to full maturity. Don't make a mistake in this matter, friend. Your eternal destiny is involved.